My name is Faith, and I am joined by the spokesperson to the President of Media and Publicity, Mr. Femi Adesina, who graciously accepted our invitation at the last minute. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
Good morning. Okay, so we are also going to be joined as we proceed on the show by Dede Mabiaku, activist and artist, as we know him, and musician. So we're going to be discussing change. Now, there was a video that was actually put on Sahara Reporters he was on Sahara TV for an interview with Dede Mabiaku, when he was talking about the change and talking about the fact that there has not been a lot of changing by Nigerians. Okay, so when he comes in, we'll get into that much more, but let's talk about the fact that I read somewhere, you know, where you were saying that Nigerians will feel the change soon. Okay, now this is something that we have heard a few times. This is 1.5 years into this administration, and there were a lot of things promised during the campaign. And I think it was last year, there were people trying to put into place the achievements of the president of the administration. But there are also things about the fact that some people feel the change, they're not feeling it. But you said that the change will be felt soon. Why should Nigerians believe that now, when for a while it's been the same thing we've heard over and over and over and over again? Why is this any different?
When you elect an administration, there is a period that that administration is supposed to serve for. And in our own variant of democracy, it is 4 years. And when an administration makes you a promise, it can't tell you that it will do it in 12 months or in 18 months, because it has 48 months to do whatever it has promised. And so this administration has 48 months to do all that it has promised. And I tell you, before the end of those 48 months, you will get to see.
So you're saying that in one and a half years, when Nigerians are complaining about the fact that, well, Forex, we do know how much the exchange rate is. We do know that it's expensive to buy commodities in the market and everything. You're saying that give us the rest, the 2.5 years left, and then we will deliver on that change. But there's also the feeling that by the time we get into 2018, all that is left is campaigning and trying to get re-elected. It's not about the people anymore.
That's maybe typical of other presidents, but it won't be typical of President Muhammadu Buhari. If you know him, he's a man that is serious-minded. With him, whether he runs or not, he has not told anybody he's running, but even if he's going to run, governance will not suffer a bit. It will not suffer. And then talking about change, listening to you, you will think there has been no change.
Has there been change?
Oh yes. Now when you want to assess a man or assess an administration, you assess them based on promises they have made. This administration campaigned on three main planks: securing the country, fighting corruption, and reviving the economy. In the first two, I would say a lot of advances have been made.
The second one, which is fighting corruption, there are people who would argue that it has been selective and it has also not been conclusive, because we have people who have been sent to court and then they go to court, they have their days, and then the cases just get adjourned. So there's no conclusion. Till now, of course, nobody has been convicted of anything.
And it is not the duty of the executive,
to do that.
Convict, yes. So,
but before
you can't blame the government.
What about reviving the economy? That is a big problem.
It is a sticky one. It's a sticky one. But will it be done? Yes, it will be done.
You think it will be done? Okay, before we get into that, because I mean, when Dede joins us, we'll get into the change conversation a whole lot more. Let's just quickly touch on issues that, of course, have been discussed so far, especially, you know, between the weekend and now. That's the issue of the state of health of the president. Now, the president did, you know, proceed on leave last Thursday, okay, handing over to the VP, and he said, you know, he's going to London for vacation and then he will have some checkups. But then there have been different stories milling around. I want us to put that to rest. How exactly is our president doing?
I'll say all the stories that have been flying around are just like stone in a teacup. Absolutely nothing to it. The president is on vacation, the president is fine. One thing that is intriguing is that Nigerians have been lied to for so long, they have stopped believing the truth. This was a president who was going on vacation, and he told you, I'm going on vacation. While there, I'll do medical checkups. And then people turned the other round, and they said, it's a medical vacation. No, the president told the truth. Nigerians should learn to believe that truth. But because people have lied to them in the past, they find it difficult.
Well, when you say people have lied to them in the past, there are also the talks of, okay, what about this administration? There are some things that, you know, the administration has said that, you know, some people categorically say, well, this is not true, or you are not proceeding, you're not doing exactly what you said. So if you say that it is about past administrations that have lied to them, there are, some people would argue with you that, what about this administration? You have not lied to us at all.
I can't recall those lies unless you begin to bring them up one by one.
As you proceed, I will enumerate some of them. But let's also address the issue of the Southern Kaduna killings. Because I did read, you know, your response to that when you were saying that, you know, it's about federalism. The president cannot, you know, talk about everything. But here's the thing. The president is the president for all Nigerians.
Sure.
So when a Nigerian dies, especially in a dispute like this, it is expected that the president, to some extent, you know, should be able to convey sympathy or empathy and show that he's concerned. But there has been this, you know, palpable silence where the Southern Kaduna killings is concerned. Federalism, that response, does it really cut it in this situation?
There was response. The police is a federal institution. The military is a federal institution. They can be deployed without the say-so of the president.
But he didn't come out to make any statement by himself.
He didn't have to.
You think he doesn't have to? Nigerians died.
Well, what I said before, I'll repeat again, and I stand by it. There is a governor in Kaduna State.
Who is a chief security officer.
That chief security officer is in touch with the president. Is the president of the whole country and the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. Now, the two of them are working together, and they have done what should be done. It does not mean until the president comes out and begins to speak that he has not done anything. This is a man that speaks more with his actions.
With his actions.
Yeah, a lot of people have a template in which they want the president to fall into. No, he doesn't have to fall into that template. Every president all over the world can determine the template that he wants to work with.
Well, the template sort of like shifted, and I'm going to, you know, stay on this a little more, because I mean, when we had the Niger Delta crisis, the president did speak about it equivocally. We knew where he stood. When we had you know, the issue of Boko Haram, we knew exactly where the president stood.
So
you were thinking, what about this one?
It's not every occurrence in those places that he also spoke about.
But he did speak about them at the end.
Oh yes, even this Southern Kaduna, he has spoken about it. He ordered the military in. He ordered that military cantonments be built in those areas and all that. So the president has done.
He has done something.
Yes.
But I mean, you are a media person. You've been practicing for years, and I'm just asking compared to you. But the issue is this: perception is everything. Yes. And if the president is perceived not to care, whatever he does, I mean, yes, that statement, that phrase, action speaks louder than words, you know, it's what we all know, it's a very popular phrase, but we're living in the world right now where perception is everything. And if the president is not perceived to care, sometimes his actions are moot.
No, it's not quite correct, because if you want to have an open mind in before you arrive at a perception, actions will matter. Actions will matter. But what we see in Nigeria is that some people willy-nilly, they have just closed their minds and they just want to
believe. So you blame them for that?
Well, they have a right to whatever they choose to believe. They have a right to it.
Well, I mean, there's that perception that, oh, the president is, you know, I'm going to ask you questions that I should have asked you like since 2 years back. You know, I mean, when the president makes a statement like the 5% that, you know, didn't vote for me and everything. So there's already a perception. in the minds of people that there are people that he doesn't consider to be part of his constituency because they didn't vote for him.
No, you fell. You fell for the gambit of those who pushed out that thing. You know, because
he didn't make the statement.
I was there, and I saw what was pushed out online and what was trending for some time. What the president said was that ideally, in a democracy, you do more for people that give you 95% than those that give you 5% votes. But how did he conclude that? He said the Nigerian constitution precludes him from being unfair to any part of the country. So he will not respond to different areas based on the votes they give him. But when that thing was going to be pushed out, mischievous people behind it removed the last part of it where he said the constitution forbids him from
But then you know that he also had a media chat where he said something close to this. What? But let's talk about the issue of court orders, obeying court orders and everything. The president said during a media chat that somebody who stole so or who did something like this, we should let him travel, we should let him go on vacation. But what that tells people is that the court has said this. You said you are now a reformed Democrat or you're a converted Democrat, so why can't you obey the courts?
Well, I wish you had the Attorney General here. He is the chief law officer. The Attorney General is the one who can tell you why that
I'm bringing this question because of perception. So when that sort of segment is pushed out, no matter what is done, every time you hear about maybe Nnamdi Kanu still being in detention or Dasuki being in detention or anything like that, the thought is, well, he did say that he wasn't going to let them go. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm talking about, perception here. It is very key.
Yeah.
And this administration doesn't seem to.
What I'll just say is that there's nobody being held without a case still pending against that person. And the Attorney General is the one who can articulate why they are being held. He can tell you what are the cases pending. So
let's talk about communication. You are the spokesperson for the president, you have a couple of other people that do the same thing. Gal Bashe, the senior special assistant, and then of course Tulu Ogunlesi, the person for media. So there are a number of people in that place, but there has been some sort of lack of cohesion in dissemination of information with this administration, and there are a number of people who actually feel that there's no communication between the administration and the people. The president doesn't talk to the people, and then when the spokespersons come out to say something, sometimes they get more defensive than actually trying to communicate to the people what is going on.
I'll be glad if you cite instances.
Well, the last one that happened about the issue of the death hoax.
Okay.
Yes. I wondered exactly how the former president featured in that conversation.
Yeah.
Because the conversation was about this president and his state of health. So why exactly was the former president dragged into the situation? I didn't get that at all. And there have been times where, some people in this administration say this and the president says that, and then you're trying to marry the two. Okay, what exactly are you saying?
No. On the instance you have cited, I wish Gary Bashir were here, he could defend himself from that tweet. But remember that I also sent out a tweet.
And now, say, God bless the people who wish the person.
May God
give them grace to repent.
Grace. Exactly. So,
was that a prayer or sarcasm?
Take it the way you want to take it.
Okay, you know what? We will get into Chidi conversation right now because Dede Mabiaku has, joined us in the studio. Welcome to the show, Dede.
Thank you.
Okay, great to have you here because, of course, the show started because you know you were actually getting to this other conversation. But the drive for the show basically was the video you put up on Sahara TV, your interview on Sahara TV, talking about the change, that this administration promised Nigerians, that the change has not happened at all. That is what you said. Let's get into that, Femi Adesina is here, so we can take it.
There's certain things we need to accept within ourselves. We're a people who are supposed to be one unit, one family. That's Nigeria. The Nigerian state is in turmoil. The Nigerian state is in pain. Let's be frank with ourselves. Too few people are there enjoying, so to speak, without realizing that they're even putting their own future in danger. When you have a whole lot of people within one family who were suffering, and just one or two are now flenjoying, let's use that word. Omo, what do you call it? That's not the kind of change that people will anticipate. I mean, you were talking about dissemination of information now.
Yes.
And I just laughed. When you have another octogenarian who's living by his name, I mean, we go by pronunciations. He calls himself Lie. The man just a lie anyhow. Every time he comes, he tells one, lights open. The children listen to these things. The children watch these things. The children hear their parents talk about it. They hear people express things. How in this generation, day and age, we are Africans, we are Nigerians, we are taught to respect elders. We are also taught that Eshinwaju Niteinwo Sare, meaning that the horse went they front, the one went they back, they look they run. If an octogenarian who is supposed to be information minister comes the first time, tells a lie, goes back, comes with another lie, what do you call that system? Is that how we need to groom what we have? It is dangerous for us as a people. We have not seen the change they promised.
That the promise. You said something, which was the issue of the jumbo salaries of the legislators and also the president. Now, we do know that when the president came in here and the vice president, they had a slash in their salaries. You mentioned the issue of the legislators. But here's the thing. He cannot do so much about, you know, the...
It's not about him.
The jumbo pay of the legislators, because they have to send their bill to the National Assembly. They are the ones who have to deliberate.
Now you're speaking my point. It's not about him. I said we are one family, for God's sakes. I'm not talking about the president as a person, as an individual.
You're talking about the entire
unit. They should call themselves to order, for Frank's sake. Look, come. You know if you tell me, say, you know they see people when they suffer for road. You know if you tell me, say, you know they see the degenerate state where our health sector day in. I mean, a country that had Yar'Adua as president who was ill when he was governor. Isn't it amazing that he did not even build one hospital to cure his own ailment? So that hospital will in turn cure other people. Don't tell me that they don't see the hospitals and what happens out there that they go to. They all fly out for medical treatment. So the common man in Nigeria is as good as dead. You don't consider them at all. It's not fair. It's about time we need to face things the right way. Build good hospitals for the people, credible hospitals. Make them go there, make them feel safe. That same hospital will save your life. Why are we traveling out of this country for medical treatment?
For medical treatment.
It doesn't make any sense. That money you're using could have been converted into something, maybe education. Maybe a Greek, maybe something.
Let me ask you this, Dede. Do you think that, you know, the government, the president, is cut off from the people? Do you think they don't understand what your regular Nigerian is dealing with?
I would surprisingly not think so. But you would understand what happens when a man becomes president in Nigeria. Many things happen. He hardly sees what happens on the streets. He's hijacked by the sycophants around him. Shebi, Nami Tokam, in wife no Tokam. Say people don't hijack the president and the presidents. We should go by things that we get directly from them. I'm not talking about castigating them because of things we presume. I'm talking of what they express.
Obvious. Okay, let's give Mr. Femi additional time to respond to that. The issue of, you know, the presidency being cut off. You know, the thing is this. I mean, you become a president, you're driving a motorcade, you know, you don't have to buy fuel. You don't have to, you know, all of those things are not your concerns. And so, you know, it's almost like you are cut off from the condition of living of the people. You work with the president. Let's talk about that. Do you think that he is not cut off with all of this opulence and everything that surrounds, you know, our government?
Well, let me go further back to address something that Dede has said. You know, talk is the easiest thing to do. He has spoken, he has said that Alhaji lies to Nigeria. He didn't justify it. I would have loved to have two, three instances that makes you conclude that this is a liar. Two, you said the man is an octogenarian. That itself is a lie. This is Alhaji Lai's profile that I've been
on Wikipedia.
Now. He was born in 1952. That makes him 65 this year. So the fact that Dede has told everybody that he's an octogenarian is a lie.
My brother.
I didn't interrupt you when you were talking.
Let him quickly respond to you on that first, and then we'll get started.
Now, so talking about a president being cocooned away, our president has said it not once, not twice. While talking to Nigerians, he will tell them, I know what you're passing through, I know how you feel. The last broadcast, that was, I think, October 1, he told Nigerians, he said, all my life I've been a salary earner, so I know how it feels when a salary is not enough to do the things you want to do. So I have passed through it, and I know what you are feeling. Let me tell you, one night, I went to see the president. Once in a while, in the evening, I just go across to his residence, just to chat with him. And on a night like that, we were talking, and I said, Mr. President, things are tough with Nigerians. They are going through hard times. He said, I know. He said, people from my own constituency come to visit me here at the State House and they tell me what they are passing through. So I know. He said, but we are here, we are working, and we will do our best. When a man tells you that, what else do you want?
I want to address, the issue you brought up in your video again. Before you get into other things, you talked about the wedding of Sarah. Okay. You were living under a rock if you didn't see the pictures, it was a great and grand celebration, and she deserves, because of course it's her day. But here's the thing, Nigeria in itself is in a recession. Let me let you, because you talked about it, Dede, so let's hear it from you, how you felt about that,
okay,
before we get his response.
Now, who is the father of the nation? Buhari. Coincidentally, he happens to be the father of the prophet. In a situation when your people are in pain and suffering, even if the family of the bridegroom want to do everything to show their wealth or express that they can do a grandiose lavish ceremony, you calm them down as a father of the nation, because there's too much suffering out there. Now, yes, the bride needs to have her day. Nobody's saying she shouldn't have her day. We have not said that. I never said that. But the level of what you do that the people see matters.
Perception, yeah.
Perception matters. Now let's go into the issue of saying did they lie. My brother, age, when would they see? When did they claim? Not really their age. wait. After all, we all day here wearing those footballers and go claim say they be 17 years old. And we know that Oladimeji Garuba was not 17, was a father when he was playing for under 17 in Nigeria. I'm talking about perception of the people, the way you look at the elders. He's an elder already. Once you cross 60, you don't become elder. So I don't see any reason why in our day and age, we would dodge.
Well, he's
from
asking
the
you for instances,
yes,
where he
My dear, look, it's open to he himself, and he knows.
No.
Justify your assertion. My brother.
That he lied to
my brother.
Justify.
My brother, I must tell you this. There are certain things that we don't even need to start digging in to justify. Because there are too many important things to talk about. No, this is not cheap talk. Because even government people, government officials have even stated it. That is not true. Why do you backtrack a statement if the first statement is right? It's not once that your information minister has backed up. My brother, let's save time and talk of productive and progressive things.
Not about lies.
Let's talk about what we can do to make this so-called change be a change.
Let's close that on this point. Wait. You have said Alagi lies and you have not been able to justify
it. Let's move on. I wish Alagi Lai was here so that we could actually have that conversation with him as well. But let's talk about this. You know, he was talking about the ceremony for Zara.
Yeah.
Now, I'm a woman. A lot of girls, they dream about their wedding. I don't, you know, I'll get there. But well, here's the thing. At the end of the day, she wants to invite me
when it's going to happen.
Oh, I will invite you. You know, the bride wants to have a great celebration. Yes. She wants to wear this, she wants to do that, she wants to do this. And so also, you know, we're talking about lavish ceremonies, but I'm also going to, you know, just extend that to, you know, the president's wife, you know, the sometimes the kind of things that she wears. I'm going to say, oh, she's wearing this. Of course, you don't expect that when you lose everything. But then, considering the state of the economy, considering the recession, considering the fact that people are losing their jobs by the thousands, people are not able to feed. You know, you have a litter of kerosene at about 400 now or so. You know, so at the end of the day, and then you see pictures of this. I was telling you about perception. These things go a long way to sort of cement a thought in the mind of the people that these people don't care about us.
Thank you.
What is your response to that? I mean, the issue of toning down some things, why is that not on the table?
I'm glad you have talked about pictures. Because I didn't see Dede at that wedding. He was not there. So he can't talk authoritatively.
Well, but I saw pictures.
That's why you saw pictures. Pictures can be deceptive. Pictures will not give you the exact impression, not communicate the exact thing that happened. I was at that wedding, the wedding lunch, I was the master of ceremonies there. Despite the fact that it was the president's daughter's wedding, I'll say it was modest.
I'm using the common thread now for what some people characterize as ostentatious living.
When the president's wife wears, and all of those things. You know that there is no ostentatious bone in his body. It was that wedding luncheon was modest for a sitting president. Well, I don't like to compare. Wait. I don't like to compare. But we were in this country. When President Jonathan's daughter got married, you know the number of cars that she got? 80. 80 cars.
How many cars is there again?
I don't know. I didn't see one.
You're sure?
I didn't see a single one.
Because there were pictures of people flying in with private jets all over the place.
I didn't see a single one. So, like you said, that young lady has a right to have a wedding ceremony. She has had it. I believe that for a sitting president is as modest as can be. And you know that she married into a very wealthy
home. He was saying they should have probably toned it down just for the sake of Nigerians.
If they did that, you can't blame the president for it. The president is a very simple, easygoing person, and that wedding for the daughter of a sitting president was simple and modest.
I want to ask this, you know, question. A lot of I remember, I think it was former governor of Edo State, Adam Sushabole, coming out to say that the change, you know, that the president's working change is already in effect. And there are several government officials who come out to say things like, you know, the change is here. How come they can see it and people cannot have a grasp of it and say, yes, the change that we voted for is here? The president just started, you know, the SIP program recently, but that is 1.5 years into the administration.
Yeah.
And even that, you know, is, I'm expecting to see somebody that actually got this 5,000. You know, like, okay, I was one of the people that got it. I want to see people who, the graduates that are not employed, you know, give us pictures, give us names, give us specific, so that, because we've had several times, he said that Nigerians have been lied to so many, they don't know when they're telling the truth. We've had so many times of, oh, we've created 10,000 jobs, we've created, no, 1 million jobs, we've created this, we've created that, and we cannot place it. Because you can't say you've met one person that has actually had that.
Onus is not on government to begin to now prove.
Too short.
No. The onus is government has too many other things to do. Now, when government tells you, we have done this, we have given social numbers this, it's up to you to believe it. And if you don't believe it, particularly if you are a journalist, the onus is on you to also fact check and prove it that you didn't do it. Government has too many things on its hands than to now begin
But you know that the Nigerian people right now, they want proof. It's not just about the truth.
It's about the fact that, like you said, there's been too many lies. So for you to be taken seriously, shouldn't there be some sort of proof?
No. When this government speaks, like I usually say, take it to the bank. This government does not lie to Nigerians.
Didn't you want to
respond to
that?
Will not lie to Nigerians.
Will not lie to Nigerians.
If some people are cynical, that's their business. If they choose to be cynical, it's also in human nature to be cynical.
No,
but this government will do what it should do, is doing it, and will continue to do it.
What do you want to say, Dede?
Let's not politicize issues here. You call that wedding model? You keep saying the things you say the way you say them, people out there listening, be real with yourself, my brother. Beside your house and around your house area, there are people who live also. When you drive in your luxury car, there are people who drive by your side and enter Kekenabeba and enter Kekenabeba and the rest of it. Nigeria is in pain. Government, not the due detail the government said they will do it. Don't defend issues the way you are politicizing them. Be real. Go to many of the states. Health centers don't function. Many places don't have even health centers. How much will it take? What will it take? Look at education. From the past, see the way they have done things. I see that you people claim you want to do things the right way. Nobody's castigating you for that. We are just saying we are not feeling it. We the people, we are not seeing it.
Because it is the right of the government to say we're doing it, and it's also the right of people to say, well, we have not felt it.
You see, let's be real with ourselves. I beg my people.
Well.
No, my brother. Just like you said that you did not interrupt.
I thought you were done.
Go on.
Let's reality speaks here. We need to fact check if that's what you claim. But this is not the time for us to start looking for fact checks at the time that we have just a few minutes to talk. And what we are doing here is to make people realize from you that it is possible for this change to work. And from me, I am part of the people to tell you that we are feeling the pain.
Because basically, we're trying to get answers. We're trying to also make sure that we clarify.
So when you say, that we...
Basically,
we should fact check by ourselves. It hurts because you are representing us. It is because of us that you are there. The people who are in government are there as servants to the people, not ogre to the people. The president is number one servant of the people. Thank you. One problem we have is that we keep politicizing things without facing truth and sincerity. Sincerity is the main factor, not politicization. It will never help us. You talk of Jonathan's wedding ceremony comparing to Buhari's, the two times are different. There was complete madness and mayhem in Jonathan's time. We know that. You've come in to tell us that time was bad, you want to change it. And we see this, and then you justify it because you were master of ceremony? Hell no, don't do that. Nigerians are there in pain, my brother.
Let me bring this up before you respond. I know you're going to respond to some of the things he has said. You know, but he talked about, you know, politicizing things and all that. One of the things that you know, spokespersons for this administration have been accused of is the defensiveness, you know, like communication as opposed to being defensive, because the people want to know, right? Like you said, public servants. So we expect that when we ask questions, we get answers. yes, there are people who are going to be cynical. There are people who are not going to want to see anything good, whatever you do. Definitely there are those people. But even those people are Nigerians. So when people ask questions, why the defensiveness in communication?
I understand what you're saying, I want to say it. Now let me pick something that Dede said to show that he's just playing to the gallery. And
me?
Full of rhetoric. So.
Me?
What did he say? Let's get some of those statements.
He said, when I drive in my luxury cars.
Don't you drive luxury cars?
I now want to tell him. When I come to Lagos here, I drive a Pajero Jeep that was bought in 2010. It's going to be 7 years this year. When I'm in Abuja, I drive a Peugeot 407 as SA Media. You know the first person that used that Peugeot? Imani Boro, who was Jonathan's original spokesman. After that, Ruben Abati came and spent 4 years. One day, Imani Boro came to my house. He saw that car. He said, Femi, you don't mean that this car...
You didn't talk about your salary being...
you mean that this car I rode 8 years ago is what you are riding. So that they can... Shoot breeze. You can shoot breeze here.
My
say,
brother.
I drive.
When I said when you drive in your luxury cars.
Hold on, I meant you people in governance.
Not you as an individual. When you talk of your Pajero now and the government car, you have just lied again.
Wait, hold on. Why are we so defensive? Can we have some order here? Hold on. When he said cars, I think he was talking about the government in general.
I'll give you information on that. Information which is in public domain. In 2015, the sum of 400 million naira was put in the budget to change the president's cars. And the president said, no, those cars in the presidential fleet can last for the next 10 years. Remove this for budget line, 400 million. Since the president got there, this is the 20th month, he has not changed his car.
Well, the president wants to buy cars for our former heads of states, and how much is allocated for that? About 400
that,
million.
That is their abuse. That is their abuse.
It's their abuse, but we're in a recession.
Come on, man.
Let me go to the question. About communication. Wait, Didi, let's hear that. Spokesman for the president, what is my duty? My duty, one, is to inform the country about whatever the president is doing. That we do. There is not a single thing that is of public interest that the president does that we don't inform the country. Two, we need to educate the country on policies, pronouncements from the president, expand on them when necessary. We do that. When this happens, we educate the people. This was done because of this and this and this, and we expand on it. And three, we must defend the president when necessary.
What does that mean, attacking the people? Let me anchor my thoughts.
Defend the president when necessary. So, when there are issues, people have misunderstood, or some people have raised allegations, it is part of our duty as spokesmen to defend the president. So when you hear us being defensive, it is just a small part
of your job. But does being defensive of the president also mean attacking the people? Because I'm going to point out one statement that you made when we were talking about the pipeline vandals.
Yeah.
And you said, well, go and go and catch them. You know, those if you're complaining about power, those are the people, you know, it's a case of
For me, that is just majoring in minor.
The truth of the matter is this. The bulk serves at the table of the president, because he is the president.
Sure.
So whatever happens with this administration, we can talk about the ministers. We'll get to that in a minute. We can talk about the ministers. We can talk about, you know, everything else. Of course, we know about the legislature. We're not getting into that because that's not your concern. But at the end of the day, this president, a lot of people went out of mass to vote for him, because he promised change. And there were expectations, maybe too high expectations, you know, but at the end of the day, people expect some sort of stewardship. And so they ask questions. And so they say, we don't have power. What is the president doing about power? It doesn't matter if we hear about vandalism. It doesn't matter if we hear about this. What is President doing about power? That's why we put you there, to make sure you deal with the situations. And then when you, the spokesperson of President, said, well, go and meet the person who is vandalizing.
Idle people magnified a sentence. I say, I stand by that sentence till tomorrow, but I stand by the totality of what I said.
What is the totality?
The totality of what I said was that as of February last year, power generation hit, I think that it was about 4,070 megawatts in February last year, and the government announced it. We have hit 4,070 megawatts, which is a record in Nigeria. Now, the following week or 2 weeks after, they start bombing pipelines. And in no time, 4,070 megawatts dwindled to about 1,000. And then some people say, there was no light. How would there be light? How would there
but that
be
is,
light?
Isn't the prerogative of the people to complain about that?
Oh, so why if some people are vandalizing installations which were put up with our commonwealth, and then you are complaining there's no light? No, you complain and tell those who are vandalizing the pipelines to stop it.
But he's our president. It's his duty to provide power, isn't
no,
it?
No, it's not.
He did promise to do that in the campaign. But let's talk about, you know, the issue of the ministers now. Okay, because you said that in your video that he needs to fire all his ministers. Why did you say that?
No, you see, when we look at some certain factors, obviously, we must understand truth first for what it's supposed to represent. In truth, Fashola is a damn good person. Working in Lagos, he made himself a hero. Great hero. Many people respect him to tomorrow because of his governance in Lagos. Hmm. Now, when you see a situation going the negative way and you don't talk about it, then you're not that person's friend. Look here. When NEPA take light in those days, you go here, NEPA, go badge for Oga NEPA, you know, go better for this NEPA Oga. That's what you hear from the common man. Now God go punish this NEPA, this Oga NEPA. Now God go punish manager of NEPA for your area. That's what we hear. I was with Fashola's younger brother. We were out. Right? We sat down somewhere. It's called Leo's Bar. We sat down there one evening. We went to eat chicken, barbecue chicken. NEPA can't take light. One person won't sit for the next table for our side, just shout, Omo, go badge for Fashola Joe. The boy was shocked. Demola, that's his name, and that's the truth. Now, why is this? If you get somebody who's technically sound to handle a particular unit, it is easier for everybody at the end of the day. You don't take a lawyer and put him where he's not.
Well, he's been an administrator.
No, he's been an administrator. It's not about administrators alone to run a system. You need the technocrats. You need there are very many young men, 34, 40, who are trained in these fields, who can give you ideal ideas of how we move faster forward. We are leaving that generation far too behind. It doesn't help us anymore. Our generation was dumped down, left behind. Very few of us were taken along. We shouldn't do that to the generation coming. There are many great trained minds out there, Nigerians who are respected. We should bring them in to handle these things. The presidency has people working with them that are educated enough to know that these things happen. These people exist. They are bound everywhere. What about now that we are in turmoil? We get the most credible to sit down and everybody else team up and tinker together and say, okay, like the person when they say fit do am best, but let's surround him. Get the administrators to sit by and run situations, not get them to sit on.
Then be the ones, man.
Thank you. It there's a big difference. It'd be like make you say, person is he don't sit down for his motor since. Driver when they drive the motor, now he's supposed to know how to drive the car past the person when they sit down inside the car.
But you know what? Just responding to that line of thought, the ministries, yes, they have ministers, but then they also have permanent secretaries and they also have civil servants.
That is where we have a major problem.
That are quite experienced in this field.
My dear, see,
isn't that the same thing you're talking
no,
about?
No, see, we had a major problem that started many, many years ago. And that major problem is what is eating Nigeria in truth, the civil service. To me, I call them civil service. Because I know Femi will not deny this. He is aware of the fact that the civil service structure in Nigeria is rotten to the core. It's painful, but it is the truth. Yes, the government is trying to prune down, cut down some of those things. That's a good job. That's a nice one. But is that how we need to go by it? The civil servants lead. Not that the ministers lead. The civil servants lead the minister. Because they are the ones that show him the areas to chop from, what things to do, and they know the corners. French people call them patisserie, the small rats that will come in and show you where the, you know, and the rest of it. It's not time for us to be deliberating over these issues of quarreling. It's time for us to see how can we go forward.
How can we find solutions to things?
A country where education is bad, and then all of a sudden the former vice president, the former president, and the rest are building universities, and so their feet know how to make good school. Then they can't wait until they come out power. Then they go there, go begin build their own country, make it impossible for common man to enter. You know, all these things should not happen. We should have a situation where right now the presidency and the legislature should look at ways to make Nigerians feel the essence of being true Nigerians. They are the ones serving us. It is their time to make things change the way they claim. To me, Buhari may not have one single bone of those people inside his body. One single bone of Tiftif people inside his body. But be frank, those around him, are they making him see the things the right way? Why are we always politicizing issues instead of being realistic with things? Nigerians out there are your brothers and sisters. We are all one people. When we see how our legislators and our executives do things they do every day, it stinks and it hurts that they don't think the common man even sees them. Who they carry una go? The common man. Who they wash the plates? Na common man. Who they wash the bed sheets? Na common man. Who they follow you build the structures? Na common man.
So they see all that. Let's give Mr. Adesina a chance to respond to that, and then we'll get into the issue of you know, the cabinets. There have been different stories about a cabinet reshuffle being imminent. Is that going to happen? Is it imminent?
When a man assembles a cabinet, he is the one who knows the timelines and the deliverables he gave each minister. Therefore, he's the best person to also assess it.
Good.
It does not mean that people can't have opinions, they can't have recommendations. Those people will have their say, but it's the man who assembled the cabinet that will have his way. And that is the position with the president. He assembled this cabinet, he knows what target to give each minister, he is the one who can determine. Has this person met the target I gave him? Has he met the timeline I gave him? Then he is at liberty to tinker with that cabinet. The problem in Nigeria with people like Dede and Co. is that they think the president is their property and they must lead him by the nose. They must be the one that will tell him what to do, when he must do it. They must even tell him how the wedding of his daughter must be conducted.
Very out of line in this.
He's a public servant. Listen, my brother, he is not a military president.
So he cannot. He's a democratically elected president. So please, my brother, respect me and respect other Nigerians out there. Your speech is out of line.
Okay.
Your statement is completely out of line. The president cannot. He has no right to say that Nigerians don't have a say in who he puts in his cabinet. You are wrong. Are we running an authoritarian government here? Come on.
I stand by what I
say. If you stand by it, then it's a big shame, my brother.
The issue of the cabinet is this. We have, I'm just going to point out one example of our sports minister. Okay, let's look at what happened with the Super Eagles. Let's look at what happened with the Falcons. Okay, and let's look at statements that have been made. Now, some of these statement you even expect some sort of apology for, you know, after making them, because there's nothing that stops you from walking back on the show and say, okay, I apologize for saying that. We didn't expect the Super Falcons to win, you know, as opposed to saying, oh no, you took me out of context, but you did say that. And so for some people, they're thinking, okay, you gave them a deadline, you give them a timeline, you give them deliverables because you are the boss, yes, but the deliverables they're supposed to, you know, get to you, it's supposed to also get to Nigerians.
Thank you.
And if the Nigerians are saying, we're not feeling this, doesn't that count for something? If the Nigerians are telling the president that they elected in a democracy that, well, the ministers that you made minister of power, minister of education, minister of health, minister of this and that, we're not really feeling their impact. Shouldn't that count for something with the president?
Just an opinion. When you talk of Nigerians, you are so general.
What about majority of Nigerians talking about that?
What? Show me the sample that you have conducted.
The survey.
To show
that it is scientific. Anybody can sit and say Nigerians. Anybody can assume that he's speaking for the people, whereas he is not. Unless there has been a scientific process.
So you're saying that
process.
You have some Nigerians who have told you that these ministers are delivering. Because, I mean, yeah, if I can give you numbers of Nigerians who have said they're not delivering, and you're saying that, well, that means that it's a general statement, which, of course, is not factual. You know, but then again, do we have a number of Nigerians who have also said these ministers are doing so good? Because if it translates to, well, I don't have power, my education, I can't pay for it. You know, education is high. I can't go to hospitals. I can't go to this. If that cry is there, doesn't that imply something? Does that have to be like a study, a clinical study and a survey?
A study is very important. A study is very important, lest we be guilty of atomism, using a small to represent the whole. A study is very important. But then, again, permit me to quote the scriptures. It says, who are you that judges another man's servant? It is before his master that he either stands or falls. The president is the one who assembled this cabinet. It's not even in my position as a spokesman to begin to assess
that. I want to ask this question. You know, the president rode in on such goodwill, right?
Yeah.
Right now, it's seeming like that goodwill is fast eroding. And I would say it seems like it.
You want to say it's a general statement.
Well, there is a call for a protest soon. Initial, I don't know if you've heard about it or seen it.
Nationwide
protest for February 5th.
Oh, sure.
Yes. So if you have people calling for a nationwide protest and saying that things are not working, is that still a general statement?
It is.
What is the response?
It is.
Wait, what is the response? What is your response?
Hold on.
I want you to answer this, Mr. Femi Adesina.
Yes. So I'll answer.
What is your response to the fact that there are people gearing up in this president administration to go for a protest?
Okay. Now, this is my response. This is a country of about 180 million people. It's impossible for 180 million people to think the same way. In fact, Yoruba have a saying that if you all sleep and you put your head in the same direction, all of you are foolish. Because you will be breathing in one another's mouths and all that. A country of 180 million people, and don't forget the last election, how it went. Somebody scored 12.5 million votes, another scored about 15 million votes. There are some people who are still in that election mode. They have not got out of it. And till today, they are still living and romanticizing that immediate past. What they don't know is that past is gone and gone forever.
So do you mean to say, you know, just trying to understand this, that whoever is criticizing or calling out the government, calling for a protest,
yes,
those people are people that are still in election mode that supported the former
majority. Majority of them. I'll tell you, majority of them. Because
Femi Rora, Femi Rora.
Will you be quiet and let me talk?
Just when he finishes, I'll let you get in a word. But I want to get.
Majority of them are people that have resolved not to see anything good in this administration, simply because the man they wanted lost at the polls. And in other countries, when elections are over, the people move forward. So one set is like that. Another are permanent critics. You know, some people are permanent critics. Whoever is there, even if an angel comes, they will criticize. So some people are permanent critics.
What about the ones that supported that are now feeling a bit?
Those are the impatient. The impatient people. Because when a government was elected, it was elected for 48 months. So why don't you give that government a chance? I spoke earlier about people who want to lead government by the nose. No, some of them are saying we voted for change. So then the president, you must lead him by the nose and he must do whatever you want him to do at the time you want to do it. No, it doesn't work that way. This is a 48 months mandate, and you must give an opportunity for the president that has been elected to pace himself and do the work that needs to be done.
Okay, let me hear you, Dede, because I knew you wanted to say something with this. Dede.
Why do you want to hear me? When he had the audacity to tell me to shut up,
no, you said I should stop?
No, my dear, let me tell you something. Listen, my dear. I will not use the word shut up.
He didn't say
that's what he said. Excuse me, play your tape back. And I walk out now on this. Thank you very much. That's the end of it.
No,
sorry. You don't have a right to tell me to shut up because you work with the government. Hell no. I am here to tell you things about truth. Not to be insulted by somebody who works in government, who wants to defend the government. Excuse me, please. The people are out there. You don't have a right to tell me to shut up. Yours was very offensive. You said, they shut up. I am the one speaking. That is wrong of you. And you need to apologize for things you do when it's wrong.
If you did say shut up.
Okay, I'm sorry. That's the end of your. That's the end of my talk with you. I wouldn't talk with a man who acts this way. I would never. Never in my life. I wouldn't tell you to shut up.
We are going to this, go.
No, come on. That's wrong, man. You don't do that.
We will get.
Hell no.
Stay here. Lagostalks 91.8.
I don't like psychophants coming to talk shit to me in public.
It is 38 minutes past 12. Yes, there were, you know, some tensionable moments in the studio just before now. You know, let's quickly just go on that break and resolve some things. But we're back. Thank you for staying with us through this conversation.